Hi, everyone. It's Senator Chuck Schumer. Thanks for the chance to share a message during your 2023 World Voices Festival, one of New York's crowning cultural events. And thanks so much to PEN America and all the outstanding staff and volunteers who brought this festival to life. I love what the festival represents, the opportunity for writers from around the world to come together and celebrate the power of free and creative expression. The written word has always helped us find our own voices, explore timely social issues, and expand our understanding of the world around us. That's why I, as Majority Leader, have fought to empower and uplift writers, to protect your freedom to express your stories and ideas. And it's why I have fought to oppose the despicable efforts to ban books in schools and restrict what can be read or taught. This is truly an Orwellian trend, and we don't need to look that far into history to see what happens when we go down the dangerous road of censorship and oppression. So my friends, as we all know, the freedom to read and to write is essential to this great democracy and all democracies in the world. It is up to preserve that freedom today, tomorrow, and for generations to come. Thanks again, my very best, and I look forward to working with you for freedom to speak and to write.
Welcome and good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight for our closing night event. I don't know, I think we should have applause to that. Closing night. We did it. 4 days, 40 events, 100 writers coming from across the country and from around the globe, gathering here in New York City. I'm happy. I may be tired. But I was trying to think about the words that came coming up in terms of what we've experienced together for 4 days. And I have to say, I love being part of this beautiful community of readers. And yeah, it was fun to be together in real life, sharing moments, looks, while attending these wonderful conversations that we were able to present this week. So I didn't start there, but I'll tell you who I am. I'm Clarice Rosa Sharif. I'm the chief programming officer for literary programs at PEN America. And our mission as an organization is to unite writers and their allies to celebrate the power of the written word and champion the freedom to write. For 100 years, PEN America has been powered by writers and champions of free expression, and at the forefront of the safeguard of our most important right, the freedom to write. But also, especially in this moment, the freedom to read, the freedom to speak, the freedom to think even. For those of you who are new to PEN America, we are a member-driven organization. We have members in every US state and chapter cities across the country, from Detroit to Tulsa, from Birmingham to Miami. We welcome all of you to help bring our mission to life. And you know, I don't need to tell you what the fight is right now. Book bannings across the country, these legislations being passed around the country. We need your help, we need your support, we need your engagement. And you can do that by becoming a member. We have my wonderful colleagues outside who can tell you more about how to do that. But we want you to be most of all engaged. Go to pen.org, learn about our advocacy efforts, our latest campaigns, and help us do the work that we do year-round. So this is our 18th year for the Pen World Voices Festival. And since 2005, the festival has stayed true to its original mission to celebrate the power of storytelling and to convene global voices across borders, language, and culture. We thank our host tonight, the Cooper Union, and our bookstore partner, Posman Books. As I say every time I have a chance to introduce an event, the best way you can support writers you love, writers you read, is to buy books. Don't buy one, you can buy many. You can gift books, it's a wonderful gift. So please support writers. And now I'm especially pleased to introduce tonight's event, For the People. I can't wait to be in that seat and just be able to take in the evening. So I'm not going to try to rush through it, but I just want to introduce our speakers. Tonight, we're so, so lucky to have Mahogany Browne, Kaitlyn Greenidge, Rachel Eliza Griffiths, Elizabeth Nunez, Imani Perry, Patricia Smith, and Tyriek White. These luminous writers have joined us for an evening and night of reading and conversation that explore and illuminate the intersections of art, history, and family in the Black literary tradition, celebrating the many ways Black writers and artists have shaped American literature and culture. So for short introductions, they really don't need an introduction, but I'll introduce them because they are just really amazing. Mahogany Browne is the executive director of Just Media. She's a writer, playwright, organizer, and educator. She's the first ever poet in residence at the Lincoln Center. Her latest book is Chrome Valley. Kaitlyn Greenidge's debut novel, We Love You, Charlie Freeman, was one of the New York Times critics' top 10 books of 2016. Her second novel is Libertie. I definitely recommend it. It's one of my favorites. Rachel Eliza Griffiths is a poet, visual artist, and novelist. Her forthcoming novel, Promise, will be out in July. Elizabeth Nunez is the award-winning author of a memoir and 10 novels, four of them selected at New York Times Editor's Choices. Her latest book is Now Lila Knows. Imani Perry is a Hughes Rogers Professor of African American Studies at Princeton University. Perry is the author of Looking for Lorraine, The Radiant and Radical Life of Lauren Hansberry, which won the 2019 Bograd Weld Biography Prize from Pen America. Her latest book is South to America, which won the National Book Award in 2022. Patricia Smith is a poet, teacher, and performance artist. She's the author of Unshuttered and Incendiary Art. She, in January 2023, she was elected to become a chancellor of the Academy of American Poets. Tyriek Rashawn White is a writer, musician, and educator from Brooklyn, New York. He's currently the media director of Lamplack Literary Foundation, which seeks to provide mutual aid and various other resources to Black writers across the diaspora. His debut novel is We Are a Haunting. So now, enough of me. I hope you enjoy the evening. Let's get started.
For My People by Margaret Whitaker. For my people everywhere, singing their slave songs repeatedly, their dirges and their ditties and their blues and jubilees, praying their prayers nightly to an unknown God, bending their knees humbly to an unseen power. For my people, lending their strength to the years, to the gone years and the now years and the maybe years, washing, ironing, cooking, scrubbing, sewing, mending, hoeing, plowing, digging, planting, pruning, patching, dragging along, never gaining, never reaping, never knowing, and never understanding. for my playmates in the clay and dust and sand of Alabama, backyards, playing, baptizing, and preaching, and doctor, and jail, and soldier, and school, and mama, and cooking, and playhouse, and concert, and store, and hair, and Miss Chumby and company. For the cramped, bewildered years we went to school to learn, to know the reasons why, and the answers to, and the people who, and the places where, and the days when, in memory of the bitter hours when we discovered we were black and poor and small and different, and nobody cared, and nobody wondered, and nobody understood. For the boys and girls who grew in spite of these things to be man and woman, to laugh and dance and sing and play and drink their wine and religion and success, to marry their playmates and their children and then die of consumption and anemia and lynching. For my people thronging 47th Street in Chicago and Lenox Avenue in New York and Rampart Street in New Orleans, lost, disinherited, dispossessed, and happy people filling the cabarets and taverns and other people's pockets and needing bread and shoes and milk and land and money and something, something all our own. For my people walking blindly, spreading joy, losing time, being lazy, sleeping when hungry, shouting when burdened, drinking when hopeless, tied and shackled and tangled among ourselves by the unseen creatures who tower over us omnisciently and laugh. For my people blundering and groping and floundering in the dark of churches and schools and clubs and societies, associations and councils and committees and conventions, distressed and disturbed and deceived and devoured by money-hungry, glory-craving leeches, preyed on by facile force of state and fad and novelty, by false prophet and holy believer. For my people standing, staring, trying to fashion a better way from confusion, from hypocrisy and misunderstanding, trying to fashion a world that will hold all the people, all the faces, all the Adams and Eves and their countless generations. Let a new earth rise. Let another world be born. Let a bloody peace be written in the sky. Let a second generation full of courage issue forth. Let a people loving freedom come to growth. Let a beauty full of healing and a strength of final clenching be the pulsing in our spirits and our blood. Let the martial songs be written. Let the dirges disappear. Let a race of humankind now rise and take control. Good evening. Yeah. I am beyond delighted to be here celebrating the closing event of the World Voices Festival for Penn, which is very, very dear and sacred to me. I would like to tell you our first group of readers who are extraordinary, kindred, vibrant, magical, fierce warrior women that I will lead in conversation. Our first reader will be Elizabeth Nunez. Our second reader will be Mahogany Browne, and our third reader will be Patricia Smith, after which I will lead us all in what I hope will be a memorable conversation. Thank you.
Now Lila Knows is a novel about a Caribbean woman who, on her way to taking a position as a visiting professor at a college in Vermont, witnesses the fatal shooting of one of the only three black professors at that college. the black professor was giving CPR to a white woman, and the police, believing he was assaulting her, shot him dead. What should Lila do? Her fiance back home in the Caribbean tells her not to get involved. This is not her business. The black professors at the college do not make any demands of her, but expect that in solidarity with them, she would tell the police what she knows. I will read two short passages. I will be skipping over some parts for the sake of time, so bear with me. In the first passage I will read, Lila realizes that no matter how she defines herself, she is considered as belonging to the pool of black people in America. So perhaps her fiancé is wrong. It is her business to get involved. It had only been 2 weeks since Ron Browne was killed, and it seemed as if collectively the citizens of the town of Mayfield had amnesia. As Lila made her way down the main street to the college, Mayfield appeared to her as the quintessential quiet New England village she had read about in travel books. One would be hard-pressed, she thought grimly, to convince a stranger that just days before, long, thick trails of blood had been scrubbed clean in front of the restaurant where a relatively young black man, a professor at Mayfield College, was shot dead by the police while astride a white woman who had OD'd on heroin. But what about the students? Had they forgotten too? Along the narrow path toward the cafeteria, which was in the building directly opposite to the academic wing of the college, Lila saw no evidence that the attitude of the students was in any way different from that of the townspeople. In the quad, the students were sitting on the lawn, clustered in circles, chatting animately with each other. Some students turned their heads towards her when she passed by, but the second she caught their eyes and was about to raise her hand in greeting, they turned back. They lowered their voices too, for the peals of laughter she had heard moments before suddenly quieted. Then she saw the banner. It was stretched across the wall at the entrance of the cafeteria, next to the student notice board. Black Lives Matter, it said. The words were written in large black letters on a white sheet. Standing in front of the banner was a group of students, male and female, all white, wearing black sweatshirts, the hoods drawn over their heads. When she reached the top step, they stood at attention, one hand raised defiantly in a fist. Black Lives Matter, one of them chanted. Lila smiled nervously. What was she expected to do, to say? Was she to return the salute? She had seen other faculty pass through the door before her. The students had not saluted them. A loud voice called out her name. Elaine, one of the remaining black professors of the college, was hurrying towards her, her colorful kaftan fluttering like wings behind her. Come, come, sit with us. She waved at the students standing by the door. They raised their fists, acknowledging her. Black Lives Matter, they chanted in unison. There are two of us, you make three, Elaine winked. Get your food and join us at our table. Us. She was part of us. The students in front of the Black Lives Matter banner had recognized her. They had drawn her into their protests, she and she alone, not the white faculty who had entered the cafeteria just before she did. Then she remembered a game she played as a child and the song that went with it. There's a brown girl in a ring, tra-la-la-la-la. There's a brown girl in a ring, tra-la-la-la-la-la. There's a brown girl in a ring, tra la 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 la, and she's sweet like a sugar and a plum, plum, plum. On her island, she was a brown girl, sweet like a sugar and a plum, plum, plum. She had said to her, to Robert, her fiancé back home, that she was black. Did that mean she was not a brown girl? That her nationality did not count? That it was more important to be black than to be a Caribbean woman? Robert had called her back later that night. "So am I black too?" he asked. "In America, you are black if there's African blood in your ancestry," she said. "And what if there is more Caucasian blood?" he asked. She was silent. "So they will define me, is that it, Lila? I must abdicate my right to define myself?" She had no answer to give him. So the second, if I may, the second passage that I would read, Terence, one of the meaning black professors, confronts Lila with her responsibility as a black woman to fight for justice. Terence was walking down the corridor when Lila spotted him. "I didn't expect a visit from you," he said, unlocking his office door to let her in. "Sit, sit," he pointed to a chair facing his desk. "I shouldn't have talked like that to you in the cafeteria. This is not your fight. I know racism doesn't always happen in America. What I meant is, but this is our country, Lila. We have to solve our problems. African Americans have to take the lead." There was an intensity in his voice that compelled Lila to make an admission she had not planned. "I saw when that policeman shot Ron Brown," she said. In an instant, Terence's face darkened and rows of thin wavelets crossed his forehead. He pressed his hands on his desk and bent toward her. His shoulders raised, the muscles on his neck strained. "Did you tell this to anyone?" "I told Robert," she said. "Robert?" "My fiance," she said, "back home." "So are you going to report what you saw?" "I'm not sure it would help," she said. "They, the police, may not put too much worth in what I have to say." "And why is that, Lila?" "I'm here only as a visitor and what, Lila?" "And I can't be sure of what?" "Of what you saw?" Terence asked. Her fingers twitched nervously. If she reported what she believed she saw, she would have to go to court as a witness. She would need a lawyer. She did not have money for that. And what would be the worth of her word against the word of an American officer of the law? She was here at the pleasure and goodwill of the U.S. government. It was the U.S. government that had granted Mayfield College permission to hire her. Her work permit could be yanked. She could be sent back home. She knew Terence was waiting for her answer. She looked down on her hands. She could not bear the glare from his eyes. "But you did see, right?" His eyes were still fixed on her. "You said you saw." "I said I saw when it happened. I cannot be sure I saw what happened." Terence threw back his head and laughed. It was a laugh without humor, a sad, accusatory laugh, a fine distinction, but a distinction all right between when and what. "But I don't blame you, Lila. Like I said, this is not your problem. You can go back to your sunny island. We live here. We have to face the racism here." "I wanted you to know," she said softly. "To know what, Lila?" "That Ron was innocent." Terence laughed again. "My dear West Indian girl, you do not have to tell us that. We know, we have decades, hundreds of years of knowing. The police are always right. Black men like Ron are always wrong, always guilty in their eyes." He began gathering his books and papers on his desk. "I have to go. Those students," he pointed to the door. "I told them I'll meet them in the library." He was dismissing her, but his condescension had irked her too. "My dear West Indian girl," he had said. He let her leave first, standing back politely at his office door to let her pass through, and then he walked away in the opposite direction. He was angry with her. She could hear his footsteps clacking noisily down the hallway. And perhaps she had given him reason to be condescending. She was a coward. She had squirmed her way out of taking a stand with her simpering when and what. And yet, she had legitimate excuse, sensible reasons for not committing herself to any statement that would implicate her as a witness, that would invalidate the police officer's claim, cause him of lying. This was not her country. She could be deported. Thank you.
Good evening. Mayo Clinic says grief is the natural reaction to loss. Grief is both a universal and a personal experience. And I reckon that is true. But as a poet and writer, I am unable to process grief without the page. I am unable to see clearly through the tears, the wonderful life and experience that will provide my sleep landscape with all those glorious memories. A joy that I can return to again and again. Similar to the way we might return to that song that reminds us of our first love, or film that reminds us of our favorite time, or visual art that ignites the visceral breath, reliving life. Rachel Eliza Griffiths, Mary Oliver, Ross Gay, Langston Hughes, all beautiful, brilliant blueprints. These are the poems and the poets I leaned on until I could find a voice for myself on the other side of sadness's river. So today I will share a poem that tends to the dirge work without forgetting the ways in which we move forward towards joy. This is "Do Not Make Grief Your God." Instead, make it a cup of coffee. The espresso percolator wheezing on the biggest eye of the stove. Consider the dress. Line up every spark you own and weep at its small finalities. Hold each piece of silk and cotton like the gone love, hero, heart. Name the garment, please. Give grief a name, then fold it origami. Place it kindly in a home suitable for royal things. Text every contact in your cell phone, "I love you, I love you, I love you, you, you." Now, try the same exercise with your email inbox. Newsletters, spam, and such correspondence, each item will bounce back with your declaration in the subject line, "I love you, I love you, I love you, you, you." Glorious chant of remembrance. Praise the ability to feel this deep, the goldfish, the grandparent, the ball player, the children detained, the spoiled water, the sewer split government, the son, the daughter, the bullet, the gift of ghosting, the promise of no more, the mother, the father, the sister, the empty womb, the empty heart, the desert branch throat clenching tightly, a name no one will speak. On the third day, pull yourself out of bed. Wake with a start. Can you feel death's bone milk? Good. This means you are among the living. Good. This means your heart is yours. Do not drink from the glass left next to the bed overnight. Do not drink from the glass of the unknown. Find fresh water. Find fresh water. Become fresh water. Pour into yourself. On the fourth day, when you wake, leave grief asleep if you can. If grief is already sitting upright on top of the duvet covers, next to your closet, by the nightstand, against the crowded windowsill, call it by the name you've crowned it. Grief will watch you make the bed and fluff the pillows with lavender oil. Invite grief for a walk. Remind it with the whisper, "We all need fresh air." You and grief move soundless beneath the sun. You climb the stairs, past the puddles of dew and undisturbed dog shit. You and grief walk side by side, hands not touching but feather wisp close. The light tips its full cup everywhere. Thank you.
A woo crowd. I like it. I came into the city a day early. There was a panel that I wanted to see, and it was women writing war. And then today I went to a release reading for an anthology of Ukrainian poets. And one of the values of this festival, I had this sudden realization while I was sitting at that anthology release, that we are all of us either remembering a war, fearing the coming of a war, or in the midst of a war. And all we can hope is that we keep writing the most important, fighting the most important war, and that's the ones that we fight with our voices. And that's why we're all here. I'm so honored to be here today. Unless you spring from a history that is smug and reckless, unless you vowed yourself blind to a ceaseless light, you see us. We are shea-shined toddler writhing through Sunday sermon. We are grizzled elder gingerly unfolding his last body. We are intent and insistent upon the human in ourselves. We are the doctor on another day at the edge of reason, coaxing a wrong hope, ripping open a gasping body to find air. We are men dripping from the burly branches of young trees, breathing last love for a world both foreseen and absurd. What reason can we conjure from the suicides of the cuffed, the soft target of the black back? In its rhythmic unreal, time keeps including us, even as our aged root is doggedly plucked and trampled, cursed by ham-fisted spitters in spasms of blinding white. See how we push on as enigma, the free out loud, the audaciously unleashed, how slyly we scan the sky, all that wet voltage and scatters a furious star, to realize that we have been granted an ancient grace. No, we didn't begin to live when, on the 19th June day of that awkward spring, we heard, uttered with no joy, monotone flecked with disbelieving, seems you and these other ones are free. There was no beginning in that moment. Our truths, the ones we were birthed with, had already met reckoning in the fields as we muttered tangled nouns of home. We reveled in black from there to now, our rampant hue and nap, the unbridled breath that resides in the rafters from then to here. Everything we are is the stuff of astounding. We are a mother humming shards of gospel into the silk curls of her newborn. We are the harried sister on the elevator to the weekly paycheck her mama dreamed for her. We are black in all the way there is, perm and kink, upstart and elder, juke in the voice, hallelujah in the whisper. We heft our clumsy homemade placards, we fold double in the gloom, snot weeping to a bladed blue song. But we will never be what those who crave us chained define as free. We will never be grateful for the taint of their voices. We will not be beholding, folded, silence as we are gifted a sliver of the America that we built. Yes, we own the stink and hallelujah of it, its burden and snarl, its bodacious black and otherwise. Only those feigning blindness fail to see the body of work we are, the body of work we have done. Everything is no less than what it is because of us. Not a single one of us believes that free fell upon us like some man-made blessing granted by a white signature in an abruptly opened door. Listen to the thousand ways we say black out loud. Hear a whole people celebrate our brief, untethered lives, then find your own place inside that song. Make the singing matter.
We have to have fun and be brilliant, as we all are. These were excellent readings. I already knew. I mean, I am just wanting to dive right in. And so I will. And I have a map, but you know how things go. I'd like to begin with something I found that kept returning to me as I was reading all of your work these past weeks and spending time with it in preparation today. And even though I've read your work in these past weeks, you live in my life and in my ways of thinking of myself as a writer and my identity. So I want to thank you and praise you all. If we could just clap. So in the opening poem of Mahogany's collection, Chrome Valley, here and available for you to take home, thank you, she writes, "When you are a black writer in America, it gets harder to ignore the bodies." And I wondered if each of you could kind of respond to this as it relates to your identity and to your writing, like in your arc of, you know, it gets harder to ignore the bodies in a sense of joy, praise, violence. Each of you has just read a piece or passage that directly centers the black body. And I don't want to say the in like the capital, the black body. We're not going to do that. We're not doing that. But could you speak to what that means? I mean, Patricia, that was a perfect segue as you were talking about these ways to say black. But as writers, as black women, as diaspora women, how do you ignore? Is it hard for you to ignore the bodies, or do you center them with deliberation? We can just go, whoever wants to leap.
I don't know. This is the first thing I thought of. I'm not really sure that it addresses the question head on. But I got introduced to poetry by getting up on stage and doing it. And it was a recreational exercise. It was wonderful. My social circles were built around that. But I had a poem at one point, and it was about an undertaker preparing the body of a young man. Mm-hmm. And the fact that the mother would want to see the body again, the things that the undertaker had to do so that the mother could see the body. And I remember doing that poem and having three women leave the room and realizing that they were picturing their children upon that slab. And at that point, I realized that there is nothing recreational about what we do. There are so many people looking for ways to tell their stories. And it's interesting that you started talking about the body, because I feel like in writing, we're taking on so many bodies above and beyond our own. There are people who are looking for ways to have their voices heard. And if we have a moment and that person happens to be somewhere in the audience and they run home and pick up a pen and get started. So what we're doing is we're trying to build the community of witnesses. And so when there is a body lying in the street or a body lying on the subway, or, you know, that's a body that we have to take upon our own, because that's a person that could no longer speak. And I'm not saying, I'm not being like, oh, well, we are speaking for them. We're speaking with them. You know, we're speaking with them. And everything that we write, I think, is a witnessing voice that is reaching out. We're not ever saying we're doing something you can't do. What we're saying is we're doing something that we can all do, and we're trying to pull you into that witnessing.
Thank you for that. Elizabeth Mahogany?
I felt like I shouldn't because it was my poem. I was just gonna listen. No. Okay, I tried to get out of it. Okay. Well, one, I feel very lucky to sit beside these legends. That's one. Two, I think it was you, Patricia, who reminded me that I get to center myself, my voice, my people when writing, because I came up in the writing world at a time where folks were like, oh, the identity politics are so benign. Like, oh my God, we don't want to hear another rape poem. Like, there was so many, there was like a list of things they didn't want people to talk about for a slam or for a performance. And all of them had to do with me. At some point, it's like, I can't even be me when writing pieces for a community. And so I wrote that thinking about there's always a body, including my own, that is, that folks are trying to erase because the conversations are uncomfortable, because it's difficult, because they're afraid of being canceled and or don't want to do the work, the heavy lifting, of which I just call living. Every day I walk out in the world, I don't just get to be a woman. I don't just get to be a mother who likes coffee or stayed up all night watching Real Housewives of Potomac. I am a Black woman, right? I'm probably considered intimidating, or which I get all the time. It's like, oh, you're so scary. I'm like, what did I do? Did I honk at you? Did I snarl? Like, what part of me is scary? I think I'm kind of nice. But
lovely.
All the ways in which we are you know, siphoned down and made small, those are, Lucille Clifton said, those are other ways of being killed, right? All those ways that you try to make us smaller and try to make us assimilate, those are bodies too. And usually it happens to Black and brown folks. It happens to marginalized voices. So yes, I'm finally centering myself in the work, and that requires me to be mindful of all of the folks who are ignored and not included in the canon.
Thank you, sis. Hi, Elizabeth.
Well, thank you very much. Those are amazing poems that you ladies read. About 30 years ago, I saw a little excerpt in the newspaper of this Black man who was giving CPR to a white woman, and the police had told him to get off of her because they thought he was assaulting her. And of course, in order to give her CPR, he had to put his mouth on her mouth. And, you know, he was bringing her alive, so he was still doing it. And so the police shot him dead. Well, that was about 30, 35 years ago. And it struck me then that I never heard anybody talk about it. I thought, was I the only person in the whole of America who had seen that, who had heard that? I was very glad when I wrote this novel and tried to fictionalize that situation that someone came up to me and said, yes, they knew about it. So I was very concerned about how, about our silence and our responsibility. And of course, we know that Martin Luther King quote about the only way for evil to thrive is when good men do nothing. And I thought that was a lot of nothing for all those years. Of course, we now have technology that films it and records it. But when we didn't have it, it didn't mean it wasn't happening. And so I was concerned about that. And then I narrowed the field to look at, well, since I am a Caribbean immigrant, although I don't really think of myself that way, but that's what people say, since I came from Trinidad to here many, many, many years ago, I began to think, well, does an immigrant have a responsibility? And particularly, does a Black immigrant have a responsibility? And particularly, does a Caribbean, an Afro-Caribbean immigrant have a responsibility? Of course, as from the excerpt I read, we have 101 reasons to stay on the sidelines. But of course, we benefit from the struggles of African Americans. We do. So we can stay on the sidelines if we want, but there seemed to be something a little wrong about staying on the sidelines while benefiting from the struggles of someone else. So I wrote the novel for that reason.
And we are all the more fortunate for it. Thank you. So as I'm listening, I'm going to veer off my map for a minute. You know, Patricia, you began speaking about the panel that you heard earlier about war. And I've been revisiting a lot of June Jordan's work. And she has this wonderful declaration she makes, which is, sometimes I am the terrorist, I must disarm. And I wondered for each of you, what are the kinds of things as you're living or coming to the page that you find you have to push back, either internally or we're talking about kind of external forces, but what are the kind of things perhaps within your inner lives, which I think, you know, it's so hard as Black women to fight to say we have interiority and we need to see characters and poems and things where we get to be very verbal and speak of that, of our dreams of needing rest and naps and coffee and laughter and joy. What might each of you say about what are the things that you had to dismantle, to use Lord's word, or disarm in order to try to get free? I know it's not something that happened in a moment, but if there's something, if there was a moment, a poem you read, a stage you were on, a book you read that saved you and opened you, could you say a little bit about that? I also know in my video there was this sound of tides, right? And ancestors and water, so we know it's not a static disarming. But in this moment where you are in your career and your life, what might you say about disarming the things that are at the front for you? You know we were going to get into it.
Wow, that's a good one too. We're all sitting here like,
we have to cook out.
We're going to have drinks after this, right? Okay, good.
I'm hydrating.
Good.
Hydrating.
Perfect. I would say, because I was reading about grief, we lost about 5 people in my family in the last 12 months. And yeah, it's like every 2 months there was something, someone was lost. And there came a time, I hit a wall at one point, and I'm one of those people who are like, oh, I'll send the food. I'm the strong friend. I'm the strong friend. And then transition number 3, I didn't know who I was. And so I think I had to come to terms with, like, me seeing depression outside of myself. Like, I see it in my family, I see it with my friend group, but I had never been able to name it for myself that, oh no, I'm going through that. And therapy, because poems ain't it, right? Sorry, it's not it. Poems is not it. Poems is therapeutic, they are not therapy. Amen. Okay. Amen. So I couldn't even write. Yeah, there was no freedom on there. I was like, what am I writing? I'm too sad to hold a pen. And I had never been there before. So it was therapy, and it was coming to terms with the fact that depression can have me too. Not just someone who's been, you know, fighting it all of their lives, not someone who writes about it and is a mental health advocate. Even me, you know, the strong friend. And I didn't give myself any space or time to ever be that kind of vulnerable until I had to. So I'm disarming the idea that the strong friend can't be jacked up.
Listen.
Y'all can be jacked up, it's okay. Break, just go ahead and break so somebody can come help clean that shit up, but you need to break before you break somebody else. You know what I mean? Amen.
Sometimes the dismantling is very close to you. I'm going to give you a little picture of my mother before I was born. She had a face full of Artra skin tone cream. Every night she would slather her face in it and sleep with her head over the side of the bed so it wouldn't be disturbed. She was trying to bleach her skin. When I was born and I was a little girl, we'd be watching television and my mother would just wordlessly reach over and pinch my nostrils shut for the length of a television program. No explanation, no nothing. It was because my nose was too broad. And then I found out later, as an adult, it was something I guess I had blacked out of, but she used to put Tide detergent in my bath water, thinking that it would gradually bleach my skin. And then when I talked to other women who grew up where I did, when I did, they said, oh, did you forget about the Lysol? I used to put Lysol on a washcloth and scrub our necks in the summer when we got too black. So the dismantling that I had to do was very, very close to me. It was my mother believing that the whiter I was, the more successful I would be, the more of a person I would be. Go to, you know, we're going to send you across the city to a white school. It was a bad white school, but it was a white school, so she thought, you know, this will do it. 800 kids in my graduating class. So I grew up on the west side of Chicago. It's a part of town everybody tells you to stay away from. And I grew up looking over everyone's head to the spires of downtown Chicago. Like, I have to escape this. The life that my mother has prescribed for me is out there. And the one poet who said, girl, if you don't look down and see what's around you, was Gwendolyn Brooks. She was the soundtrack of the Chicago Colored Girl. Listen to the preacher, listen to the corner store guy, listen to that postman, listen to that porter on that train, you know. What you are trying to do is pass up who you are, to trample who you are to get to people who do not want you, you know. So I learned, you know, I was raised that I wasn't good enough and that I was gonna have to struggle to get past all these other no account people to get to the promised land. And it was poetry that saved my life. It was the voice of Gwendolyn Brooks saying, you are already where you belong.
Thank you.
I'm just stunned.
Right.
I'm just stunned. I'm just stunned by your honesty, because they would say in the Caribbean that this doesn't happen. I can tell you it does. I can tell you that because our islands, I'm speaking about the English-speaking islands, because our islands were colonized by the British, we understood that you keep your skeletons in the closet and you lock that door. And I am a very strange person in my family. I have 5 sisters and 5 brothers. I am strange because, and all living and well, so far. I can tell you that every time I go back to Trinidad and I'm sitting at the table for dinner, I get kicks all over the place, on my shin, on my leg. I don't know what it is. I said something I wasn't supposed to say. And in America, if I said it, nobody would blink. You know, you can talk about your life, but you can't. I remember that one of my sisters, and I'm confessing, I hope she can't hear, but she's not here. She had a black and blue bump on her wrist, and it was caused, she was like about 16, and it was caused from sucking her hand like that, to the point where it was deeply black and blue. Well, I bring my little American self. You need a cure for that. You need to go and address that. And I mentioned this. They jumped on me like I said the worst thing in the world. You know, no, you don't talk about that. You don't talk about that. And so I listen to these lies all the time that we don't have colorism in the Caribbean, that we don't have that kind of racism, and it's there. It's so there. It's so there. You can just look at who's on top, who's below, who has the money, who doesn't, who gets invited, who doesn't get invited. I mean, it's there, but we don't talk about it. But I just want to say that the person who changed my life for me was reading Toni Morrison's Song of Solomon. I was living on the Upper West Side at the time, and I opened that book and read that book, and I say that I was so full of whatever it was that I got out of my house and I ran for blocks and blocks and blocks. I just couldn't stop running. To think that a black woman had written this, it was just, and it gave me a lot of permission. Well, I can write too.
I want to go for a second back to my map. Patricia, I'm so, your Unshuttered collection, which I know everyone is taking home this evening, it's so amazing, and me being also a photographer, the kind of conversation of images of African Americans in the early 19th century, and then to kind of give that voice, imagine voices and histories and memories to the gathering, almost a roll call that you've created. And many years ago in 2006, when I first met both of these beautiful women at Cave Canem, Patricia had sent a photograph of one of these kind of portraits, and we were working on persona poems. And I had never had a teacher or someone to say, you know, you can do this with a poem. You can look and center in a portrait, you know, what a portraiture means. And so I'm struck by that. So there's a quote that you have from Zora Neale Hurston, which I think all of you are pretty familiar with, which is, there is no agony like bearing an untold story inside you. And in your closing poem, Patricia, you write, when you were straightening your backs for us and fathoming our names, could you have known how much escaping never ends? You froze, captured a story that you knew we'd need, a story we're just learning how to read. It's an extraordinary poem, and it's this kind of moment which suddenly reminded me of Toni Morrison's Jazz, where at the end, she bleeds up through the page. She's looking at Harlem, she's looking at black people, black tradition, black radical style and speech and barbershops and all of these different places that we all see and islands and just speaking to all of it. And you do that in this gorgeous poem. And I want to ask each of you about this kind of question about the escaping and how it never ends. You know, could you tell us a bit about that last poem, Patricia, and then could you have known how much escaping never ends? And I think there's something bigger about literature and identity, but particularly for us sitting here and occupying our bodies and our minds and our ideas and dreams right now in this moment on this stage with all of you, about escaping and America and white supremacy and this kind of violence that is everywhere. And then this kind of frozen thing of the image or the person or the portrait of the self. I'm rambling on and on, but I'm mad at this timer, y'all. I'm mad, but I'm gonna get over it because this was amazing. But can you talk about that escaping? Is it the place of the imagination for each of you that you escape? Or is it the admiration of ancestors in ways that they escaped oppressive tactics by their imaginations and their actions and their agency, by their defiance? I wonder what you might think of that. I wish I could say the whole poem, but maybe Patricia, if you could lead us into the poem.
Okay, so Unshuttered is a book of persona poems accompanied by images of 19th century African Americans, daguerreotypes, tintypes, amber types, things like that. And So it's a series of persona poems, but at the end, the ending poem, it is them speaking directly to us and us speaking back to them. And when I talk about escaping never ends, in their time, escaping was a very clear-cut thing. This is what's holding us down. This is the oppressive thing. This is what we need to get beyond. And thinking that maybe 100 years from now or 200, this will all be over. This will all be over. We'll all be equal. But the longer we go, the more ways that people find to oppress us. So in looking at that now, we're constantly at war with our bodies, with other people's bodies. It's not just race, it's gender, it's everything, you know. So the idea of escaping one thing and being free is no longer makes sense. You're free of that one thing, but then you move on to the next thing. You know, what else, what's my next war? What do I have to fight, you know? Looking back and saying, you couldn't have known, in the way that you think about escaping, that it never ends. Thank you for giving us what we need to continually recognize what the next fight is, but also to recognize that there will always be another fight.
Elizabeth or Mahogany?
It just so happened, I think just this morning, one of my, we talk all the time, even, you know, thanks for the phone, WhatsApp, the free calls. One of my sisters was observing somebody on TV, and she calls me up and she said, did you see this person on TV, how wonderful she looks, et cetera, et cetera. And I said to her, you know, I will no longer be a prisoner to those values. I will no longer do it. We have to stop. You have to make up your mind that you will no longer. So she got really mad with me, of course. I mean, big fight. But the point, she said, the point is, yes, you're making a value judgment all the time on how somebody looks. And you're doing it to yourself. And you're imprisoning yourself. And it has taken me years, but I'm there. I don't really care. Mm-hmm. You know? And especially women, we have to drop that. That is so ridiculous.
Tired.
Mahogany.
I just want to listen to them. escapism. Definitely the poems. I'm able to find escapism in like a poem a day or a split this. Those moments where somebody else is finding poems for you and sending them to your email inbox. That's a good moment for me, but also my friends. My friends are a good moment for me because when life is really real, as it has been, I always have one of them Black women friends that's like, let's go somewhere. And I know that is my grandmother's. Both of my grandmothers are now passed. I know that is them because they were both afraid of flying. They were like old school, only Amtrak babies, like 5 days to get somewhere, girl. If you don't get on that plane, they were like, not me. But now I'm going everywhere and I'm doing it for them. So that feels like that you said the aberration of the ancestors. That feels like it. That feels very much like a, not only am I making them proud, but I'm reminding myself that there is life outside of America and them, the news channel. There's life outside of Fox News. There's, my God, today is something else to be seen, and I want to see it. So, yeah.
Thank you. Yes, could we please? I can't praise you all and thank you enough for our conversation. It's been so powerful and joyous and wonderful. This concludes for now our conversation, but we're all having these conversations with each other on the page and in our own behaviors and actions and what we choose to do and to pretend not to know and what we then do from what we do know. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. It is now a sublime, sublime delight to welcome Kaitlyn Greenidge and Imani Perry and Tyriek White to the conversation. Thank you.
Can everybody hear me okay? Perfect. Good evening. We're at the very end of this beautiful festival and of this wonderful event. Thank you so much to everyone who's here. I have the really distinct pleasure of getting to be in conversation with two writers who I very much enjoy, Imani Perry and Tyriek White. I sort of struggled with, what to write as an introduction this afternoon, so I thought, when I'm struggling for words, I often, like many writers, I look to other writers for what to say. In the flyers for this event, there was a quote from a Gwendolyn Brooks poem. So I took my wonderful, beautiful reissue of Black Women Writers at Work. This is going to be a little bit of a plug for this book. If you don't already have this book, Haymarket Press just brought it back into publication after being out of publication for almost 40 years. It's a beautiful book of interviews with everybody from Gwendolyn Brooks to Lucille Clifton to Toni Morrison to Tony Kadebambara to all of sort of these people who make our literary traditions so rich and wonderful. And so I was looking at the Gwendolyn Brooks interview, and she actually talks a little bit about since we're talking about For the People, one of these ideas of what it means to be in community as a writer, and what it means to be part of communities of writers. So I'll just read her words here. So this is Gwendolyn Brooks. She says, "In 1967, I met some new Black people who seemed very different from youngsters I had been encountering in my travels to various college campuses. I'd been meeting some rather sleepy, unaware young people. I'm sorry to say many young people are now returning to that old sleepiness, but with a difference. I have more hope for them now than I used to have because I cannot see us going back to the temper of the 50s. But I'm getting ahead of myself. I met some of these young people at a Black Writers Conference at Fisk University in 1967. They seemed proud and so committed to their own people. I was fascinated by them. I returned to Chicago, still going over what they had said to me. The poets among them felt that Black poets should write as Blacks, about Blacks, and address themselves to Blacks, and I had never thought deliberately in such terms. I wasn't writing consciously with the idea that Blacks must address Blacks, must write about Blacks, but much of that early work was addressed to Blacks, but it happened without my conscious intention. As a group, we workshop people did many exciting things. We would go to a tavern and just start reciting our poetry. Haki Marubuti, excuse me if I mispronounce his name, usually let us in, and he would say, look folks, we're gonna lay some poetry on you, and then he would start reciting his poems, which were relevant. Relevant poetry was the only kind you could take into that kind of situation. Those people weren't there to listen to poetry spelled with a capital P, and the kind of poem I could recite in that atmosphere would be my short poem, We Real Cool. And later on, once that atmosphere had been set by a couple of the others who had brought tight, direct, bouncy poems, the audience would be softened, so to speak, and ready to listen to something of my own with more length, something like The Life of Lincoln West. I'm trying to create new forms, trying to do something different. I'm trying to write the kind of poem that could be presented in a tavern atmosphere or on a street corner. I always like to use the tavern as my recitation's background symbol." So I was just thought that was just a really wonderful, just one of the perspectives of how in the Black American literary tradition, Black writers think about their work in connection with community, in connection with audience. That's the eternal question, especially for those of us who are writing underneath, that sort of famous idea of the double consciousness within the veil, those of us who understand that we are both within our own community and part of this sort of larger dominant culture, which is actively working against us. So if you're a creator, the question that becomes very urgent, whether you want to acknowledge it directly in your work or not, is who are you actually creating for? Are you creating for, you know, yourself? Are you creating for your community? Or are you creating for this wider mainstream audience? Or is it a combination of the three? And I think every writer tonight, everyone who has been on the stage, I can say that their work really resists the idea of translation or trying to fit interpretation or trying to paraphrase or footnote. And I just find that so interesting that people, how Black writers sort of choose to do that kind of work and how that informs everything about the work, craft, where and how you publish, what your subject matter is. That's what I'm hoping to talk about today with Imani and Tyriek. So very excited to bring them to the stage. I'm hoping they come soon. Yes? Here they come. And we'll sit down. I'll leave mine over. Thank you so much to both of you for being here. Very excited. We've already introduced and said everything wonderful about them. Everyone knows all of your accolades. Wonderful. Very, very excited to talk with both of you. I'm going to start with, let me bring up my first question. So who are you writing for?
Should I begin? I'm so delighted to be here with you all, brilliant writers, and the folks who've already been out. I find that to be a really hard question because I will tell you, I'm sometimes irritated when people say to me, well, I know you're not writing for me. And I'm like, I'm actually writing for everybody in the sense of like, everybody is an audience.
Yes.
But the for, it sort of depends on what for you mean, right? So in terms of advocating for, I have a particular interest and love for Black people, for poor people, for oppressed people, for and wanting to tend to our tradition and in a kind of very particular way and operate with a love. Mm-hmm. For the people, mm-hmm. So it depends. So everybody, and also a particular somebody's.
Yes. How about you?
Very similar. And you know, I want to start by just saying how honored I am to be here. You know, Prophets of the Hood is like began my entire kind of like framework for how I think about the world. So, thank you, Imani. Thank you, Kaitlyn. So I'd say I write, you know, and it kind of goes along with that Barbara T. Christian sort of idea of, like, I write to survive, right? And thinking about, like, you know, my own survival and my community's survival and writing toward ways of thinking about alternate futures, alternate ways out, alternate ways to survive and thrive. And I think my work is very much, you know, interested in not necessarily, you know, just Black communities, but like understanding the nuance of, you know, certain intersectionalities. So class, gender, sexuality, sort of exploring the complicated nature of how we think about Blackness, how we exist in Blackness.
In that vein of sort of complication, this is kind of an old school question that I think people often bristle at, but I'm going to ask it anyways, which is, what do Black writers owe other Black communities, if they owe other Black communities anything at all?
I will say the truth.
Uh-huh. The truth.
Yeah, very much the truth.
I get a bee in my bonnet over this. I'm gonna not do this the whole time we talk, but one of the things that I think the larger society struggles with, understanding is that we really do like being black. Mm-hmm. We don't want to be anything else. Yeah. And I think, and people are like, how could that possibly be, right? We've done everything to, you know, to destroy their lives, and they yeah. still like, right? And that actually is something really profound about what black people have figured out how to do in terms of creating beauty mm-hmm. and joy in the context of this extraordinary tradition. And I think that we have a responsibility to tell the truth about that. And there's a lot of pressure from a lot of, there's a lot of desire to, eliminate, from a lot of forces to eliminate that part of the story.
100%, yes.
Right?
Yeah.
But that part of the story is actually part of what makes what has been done to us actually so shameful, because we've taught people how to be human mm-hmm. at the deepest level. So,
yeah. Beautiful. I think that's so true, and I think the truth is such a wonderful and succinct and at the heart of the matter, because the truth isn't necessarily easy, and the truth isn't necessarily something that everybody wants to hear at a certain point. And the truth also doesn't need to be brutal either. The truth That's can right. be something very beautiful and something very welcoming. And remembering that all of that complexity is within what we attempt to create or what we try to create. And knowing that so much that is written about our communities is not interested in the truth. It's propaganda for another purpose, you know? Yeah. Let's see here. So this is a little bit of a silly question, but I'm assuming that most of those in the audience are writers or are in conversation with writers. So in this idea of community, shifting a little bit to think about community writing communities, what are some of the best instances of community and respect that you've seen in writing friendships or in writing groups?
Well, historically, I like to look at the Harlem's Writers Guild, like the 40s, 30s, mm-hmm. And it's like basically how Maya Angelou started writing, and you know, and thinking about the Harlem Renaissance writers who are part of this group. So it was amazing thinking about, like, you know, historically or contextually, like, how would black groups, black writing groups, like, how would that look? How would we push each other forward? How would we motivate each other? Mm-hmm. And recently, you know, I've had the benefit of being a part of Kalaloo Writing Workshop, which is historically invested in young black writers across the diaspora, and, you know, working with, like, Ravi Howard and Jacinda Townsend. It was incredible. I guess what made it such a fruitful sort of environment was, again, back to this point of honesty. You know, you could be honest in those rooms in a certain way. You can't really mm-hmm. be honest in certain other spaces, you know, i.e. like MFA programs or, you know, other writing groups that necessarily don't have people who look like you mm-hmm. or relate to you in certain aspects. So I think, like, having people who see you in a sense, or at least see, you know, where you're coming from, that kind of produces an environment that is generative for black writers. That's like, all right, I can honestly maybe, you know, critique, not necessarily like, I mean, and even if it is like a political thing, like that bleeds into form, that bleeds into craft. So just being honest and chafing up against people's ideas or like ideas of themselves or their writing.
Hurston Wright was really, Writers Week was super important for me. Mm. And I think that, I mean, just to just to echo that point, the institutions, whether we're talking about the cave canem, dark room, the sort of the investment over long periods of time to create those kind of cultures that we've had for, really 100 years.
Yeah.
It's extraordinary.
Yeah. You were saying like time, and I think for me, like, that's part of it too, is like we are in a culture that increasingly tries to convince writers especially that we are content producers and not writers, that we're supposed to be sort of like effectively and regularly producing work on some, on a cycle that is easily marketable. And when you work in a community of other writers, you realize how false that way of thinking of the work is, because, one of my sort of like great joys of being friends and conversations with writers is seeing over the course of a life of a project to see someone work on something for 5 or 8 or 10 or 15 years, and someone else is working on something for 2 years, and someone else is working on something for, like 7 months or whatever. You see really how beautifully sort of varied that way into the work is, and like that's actually the valuable part of the work we do in the space that we do, is that it actually really can't exist in this false sense of time that's destroying our planet on all levels as we speak, so that's part of it too. So we've talked about the wider Black communities that we belong to. We've been talked about writing communities, and I'm going to go back to the idea of sort of like our original group of communities and connections that we have. And how does your family history and sort of understanding of family feed into how you approach writing and the craft of writing?
I think family has played a huge role. That's the base of where I got a lot of these stories from, especially that show up in the book, my first book, We Are Haunting. And I think, reveling in photo albums, reveling in sort of the folklore that my dad or my older brothers or my cousin would tell me, or my aunts, my mom, existing in those spaces, and kind of thinking of the archival as an act of summoning, like looking through obituaries and photo albums again, but being transported to those spaces or bringing that ancestral energy, into the present or into my life. So that's why I think of it as summoning. And that it works its way into the craft, into the form. There's a sort of blackout poem in the book that's literally an artifact. It's an obituary of my grandmother that I, created a poem out of, but like literally sort of embedding the work with the ancestral, with generations. Just thinking of the archival as like kind of bound to the art object, if that makes sense.
Yeah,
absolutely. I think there's something to be written in particular about how important our grandmothers are to us.
Mm-hmm.
But my grandmother's at the center of everything that I write, and always has been. But I also think there's this Gil Scott-Heron quote where he says there's no better place to come of age if you're a person who loves literature and language than in the southeastern corner of the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And so that the importance of language and play with language, and I think of hearing my mother recite poetry and tell stories, and so growing up, so the sort of that idea that we sort of live with storytelling. There's also, I remember a beautiful moment years ago when someone asked Edwige Dantacott, what were your favorite books as a child? And
yes.
She was like, we didn't have a lot of books around.
Yeah.
But she said, well, we had storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think, that's where we, that's so much of where we learn the craft. So it's it's hugely important for me.
That leads into my next question, which, what for you is the difference between history, memory, and stories?
So, I think that for me, one of the, and this is on my mind because I've been writing about Zora Neale Hurston and Catherine Dunham this past week, and you know, and Hurston is a person who said researchers formalize curiosity. I think at our best in our tradition, we disrupt those distinctions. And we have this extraordinary body of thinkers, I mean, across the board, Black writers who reject the sort of strict boundaries between those categories. History, you know, I'm an academic, so I think of history as like, you know, having these sort of formal qualities that you have to, you know, in ways you have to legitimize your sources and your story in order to enter into the conversation with other scholars, right? And that has its function, but in how we, you know, how we actually do the thing that we do, there's so much mysticism, even when we do a lot of serious research, you know, and the thing that drives the research is these associative journeys, right, where we're like inspired by something or a sensory experience with an old document, or so there are distinctions, but I think at the best work they kind of collapse.
How about you?
Similar, those borders or differentiating sort of qualities become troubled, you know. Especially for us, kind of think about our history. Our history is such a surreal history. And like you said, entrenched in kind of that mysticism. Sometimes it's hard to tell kind of what is the folklore and what actually happened. Or, you know, like, take for instance, grew up in a community where, like, you know, we big up our, like, OGs, we big up our, like, you know, our heroes in the neighborhood, and sometimes that folklore, you know, like, is bigger or larger than the person, but we remember what that is, or what we felt. So yeah, I completely agree, that becomes troubled, in a sense.
Yeah, I think so much about how, you know, you were sort of saying a little bit earlier about like the archives being embedded through your work, and how much of Black history has a very complicated relationship to official archives and to what archives can and cannot tell us about our past and ourselves, and how much we, you know, our cultures and our communities know that about archival stuff and about official documents, and so, you know, have this whole counter history, counter, you know, to borrow from John Keane, like counter narratives, like these other ways and understandings of talking about history, because we know what has been deliberately left out, and what will sort of like never be told. We were talking a little bit about truth earlier, sort of like what doesn't get told. And to me, it's always such a fascinating question, because memory, you know, the nature of memory is that it's not direct, it's not stenography. You're not like taking down directly. It's so influenced by a person's perspective and whatever. And you know, you can get, as someone who's writing or trying to like bring it together, you can get frustrated by that and be sort of like, well, what is real or what is not? Or you can just really accept it and just go with it. You know, like both of you have probably had this experience of doing oral histories with elders and just having to go with it. You know, you're just like, all right, we're here, we're in this story. You know, you're telling me one thing, the other person who I interviewed 3 weeks ago told me something else, but I'm gonna go with both of these things, and I'm gonna try and find and make something that is beautiful out of this, that is outside of sort of like, did this happen or did this not happen? Is this true or is this not true? Can I find documentation or can I not find documentation? If I walk away from those questions, what more interesting things can I start thinking and sort of talking about? Which I feel like is so key to marginalized people's histories, right? Because so often, I mean, you both work in Black historical spaces, like so often our Black histories, like what gets written about Black history is really obsessed with that stuff. You know, like who was the first? Who did it first? Who was here first? Who, that's usually what people are obsessed with, is who got to a white space first? And it's like, what would it mean if we said Black history was not concerned with that actually at all, and we're actually concerned with, you know, ourselves, you know, what our stories are. And that's sort of what happens is when you allow this other space that you guys are sort of talking about to come through. So, let's see. This is, I think, a complicated question for both of you, but is academic theory useful to your work and to your process? And I'll say this came from when I was starting to write the introduction, I was trying to look at what writers had said about community and writing in community, and I came across this Flannery O'Connor quote, and I was like, I cannot quote Flannery O'Connor in this introduction, because an ancestor will come back and haunt me for good reason. But there was a Flannery O'Connor quote where she was saying, when writers write in isolation, they can fall sway to theory, but if they write in community, they won't. And at first I was like, I don't know if I agree with any of that. I don't know if I agree or disagree with that. And it's Flannery O'Connor, so what theory is she scared that people are gonna become dissuaded by? Whatever, so I went down that rabbit hole, but then I was like, that is a really interesting question of like, how much do we think and sort of get caught up in the theoretical part of it? And because both of you write across genres and are interested in sort of playing with these ideas and genres, I was super interested in what theories and if theory informs what you do.
here's one example of who I study, but also with. I think it's the approach to theory, like, mm-hmm. you know, and how it manifests. So a big part of my book was Orlando Patterson's sort mm-hmm. of idea of social death, mm-hmm. right? This kind of idea of, you know, slavery and citizenship and existing in this sort of liminal in-between space. He says between community and chaos. Mm-hmm. And so my book is about ghosts. It's about, you know, finding ancestral answers and having that conversation and like, how do you find ways forward? So if a lot of my characters exist in this literal in-between space between community and chaos. They roam the community, but it's again, troubled by the supernatural, by like, questions of life and death, and like, so that theory, and it informed so much of like how I wanted to deal with life and death, especially in a community where they want us all dead, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. So what would life mean? What would death mean? What would traversing kind of that in-between space look like? And kind of playing out that theory like very literally. And you know, social death, it isn't just slavery, you know, it's sort of, you think about abject poverty or the prison industrial complex or the state occupation of most public housing neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. So, just playing out certain theory and, you know, seeing the creative or like the kind of ways in, you know what I mean? So I could understand it. And so like, you know, kind of, you know, taking some of this stuff from the ivory tower and like grappling with it, you know, sort of on the ground level in our communities and our neighborhoods, like how that would look. That's my example.
Mm-hmm. You know, so I mean, when I write theory, yeah. like critical theory, and So it's important to me, but I'm always telling my students, especially my graduate students, that theory comes from life. Right? Mm. So you theorize out of the material circumstances of people's lives. Mm-hmm. And so theory should not ever be so abstracted that it can't also refer back to people's lives, mm-hmm. right? That it needs to be a dynamic relationship. And I think that art, in a sense, it's a different form, but it has a theoretical component, right? Because you're telling a particular story, you're creating a particular image, but you're doing so in order to open a window into thinking through the world. So in some ways, it's a formal distinction, mm-hmm. but it's sort of doing much of the same thing, mm-hmm. you know? I think the thing that I worry about, though, is when theory is applied in a way that then, like, the complicated mess of life doesn't have space.
Yeah.
Right. So that's the thing when I think it's like when it's too tidy.
Yeah.
Is the yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. We're at 5 minutes, so I'm trying to find a nice place for us to come to an end around. What's a story you're fascinated by that you hope to write someday? A story or an image that you're fascinated by that you hope to write about someday?
My homies in here, he'd be like, yo, he been bugging me with this for a minute. Mm-hmm. So Robert Church was the first Southern millionaire, apparently, and he gained his wealth post-Civil War. But I don't want to write, like, you know, and I think that's like the kind of grab, right? Because a lot of black people want to read about sort of black capitalism. They want to mm-hmm. they want to read about, like you said, mm-hmm. kind of the first who are the first black people to white spaces. But I don't want to do that story. Robert Church invested in Ida B. Wells and her. Her sort of journey exposing lynching and her journalism. He funded W.C. Handy, who is one of the architects of blues as we know it. And Memphis post-Civil War was such an insane place. And so my way into that story would be, you know, kind of black people post-Civil War mm-hmm. and kind of just exploring the construction of Beale Street, because Robert Church basically built up Beale Street as we know it. Yeah. So just that's a story I'm like.
Have you read, it came out during the pandemic, it's a biography of Mary Church Terrell, his daughter. And you should read it. It's fantastic because he had a really complicated relationship with her mother. Mm. And her mother also was very successful, like, hairdresser. And the two of them had a very messy, messy, messy marriage and divorce. Very juicy, messy marriage and divorce. That's all I'll say. And you should check it out. And that sounds fantastic. Yeah, I would love to read whatever you write about him. It'd be really lovely. Okay.
What I'm going to write about tonight, keep trying to write about when I get home, is the 1956 Newport Jazz Festival and Duke Ellington's band performing and Paul Gonsalves, who is a Cape Verdean musician, having a 27-minute solo of Crescendo and Diminuendo in blue.
Oh, wow.
And it's extraordinary. And, you know, it's like the second year of Newport, and I'm, like, trying to contrast that moment in Newport having jazz, like, you know, with all the fancy, you know, what Newport is like, in the same summer that the women in Montgomery are walking and carpooling to work. And I'm just trying to get that that moment and try to do an iterative space between the solo and what's happening in Black life that summer.
Yes, yeah. Is that the same year that Nina Simone was playing the Newport Jazz Festival or no?
I don't think she's there that.
So she wasn't there that early?
That early.
Okay, That sounds fascinating. That sounds amazing. Beautiful stuff. Thank you both so much for this. This was such a lovely conversation. Thank you.
I won't ruin the moment because, you know, I want people to leave the space thinking and remembering all the wonderful things that were said tonight from the stage. I'll just say thank you. Thank you. But thank you to all of you for coming. Thank you for participating in the 2023 PEN World Voices Festival. This festival would not be happening without the collective work of an extraordinary team. So I just need to at least shout out Sabir Sultan, who is our associate director. Yes. Jenny Tibbles and an amazing, amazing, amazing seasonal festival team that worked day in, day out to make this happen. And finally, one day somebody asked them what the festival means to them, and they said, you know, I've been coming for years after years, and this is the one place where there's always wonderful encounters and discoveries. And really my wish for tonight was that all of you and all of us were reminded of the Black brilliant minds and tradition that have come long before us, but it's not the past, it's the future. Everybody who was on that stage is writing now. You should know their work. If you don't know, please, now you heard a little taste. Check out their scholarship, their fiction, their poetry, and then discover the next generation of voices. Tyriek is here. He just published his debut novel. Let's support our next generation of writers. So thank you, everyone. Thank you.